So in this video, I wanted to talk about my 2020 RAV4 Hybrid Limited that I am on my first road trip with right now. I thought I'd take you along on this trek across West Texas where it is beautiful. I am surrounded by mountains and desert. And I'll also talk about some of the pros and cons of the RAV4 Hybrid Limited or just RAV4 hybrids in general. So if that sounds really fun, smash that like button and be sure to subscribe. And yeah, let's get on the road. I'm actually in El Paso, Texas right now, which has a ton of culture and it's just beautiful. There's nature, there's mountains, there's all kinds of cool architecture, lots of things to see. And let's explore El Paso. Four tacos.
You know the name.
Yeah. Y'all are trying to see me eat more on camera. I think this is my sixth taco. I can't stop. So probably my favorite part about road tripping is just driving around in random places and seeing cool things like this. This just caught my eye. I happen to be driving by and I love that there's these mountains in the background and these beautiful colors. Looks like some kind of skate park or something. Sometimes you gotta stop and just smell the roses. What caught my eye about the RAV4 is the style of it. It's definitely bigger, of course, than the Prius. And I really, really love that. It's like this SUV, but it's also kind of compact. I love the styling of it. It kind of feels like a huge Prius, but you know, obviously it doesn't get as good gas mileage as the Prius because I was getting about 55 miles to the gallon with that car. So I do miss that a little bit, but in my RAV4 Hybrid, I'm getting about 44.4 miles to the gallon. And I will say that I drive very economically. You know, I don't drive super fast. I'm always that slow person driving really slow in the right lane. And I'm sure it drives some people nuts and people are always like speeding around me. But I think it pays off in the long run because, you know, 44 miles to the gallon. This car is actually rated at about 40 average city and highway. So to be getting way more than that is really exciting to me. I actually wanted to get a new version of this RAV4, but I ended up getting it used. But yeah, it's the limited trim, so it has all kinds of goodies in there, including these rails on top, a panoramic sunroof on top as well. And on this road trip, it's really cool to let in some of that sun and just to experience a little more nature. You know, at night you can see some stars through that sunroof and stuff. This car kind of looks really awesome and fun and kind of sharp from all angles, in my opinion. So let's open up the driver's side and you can see what it's actually like to drive this thing. It feels nice and spacious, heated and cooled seats, which I really, really like. These extra floor mats were here when I bought them. As you can see, there's dust and sand, so it's catching all that stuff. Gives me a peace of mind that I'm not like messing up this expensive car. And this is your view when you're driving. I think it's pretty sleek. I like the steering wheel and the layout of these buttons. This is adaptive cruise control, which works really well. When you have adaptive cruise control enabled, this button will tell the car how close or far away you want to be from the car in front of you. And then this is lane turn assist, which works pretty well, especially for this road trip. But yeah, I like the simplicity of this wheel layout, and the limited trim does have these kind of faux leather accents on here. I've never had a steering wheel that had these kinds of padding, and I was always like, I don't really need that. Why would I need padding on a steering wheel? But then once I actually used padding on a steering wheel, I was like, okay, I see why this is here. It's very comfortable. This is the main control panel and odometer, and all of your info is going to be in this panel here. So you can see that on this road trip, I have driven 778 miles already. Wow, that's a lot. And if you wanna change your trip A or trip B, there's this little button here, and this shows the main odometer. So far I've driven a few thousand miles on this myself, because when I bought this car used, it had about 17,000 miles on it. So as I was saying, you can see that my total average since I started driving this car is 44.4 miles to the gallon, which is a really incredible number considering how big this car is. But yeah, it is a hybrid, and that was really important to me for saving money on gas and also being lighter, you know, on the environment. This also shows you that this is an all-wheel drive, and that really came in handy the other day when I was driving on, you know, pretty rough terrain over some rocks and lots of bumps, and the car handled pretty well. It's a little bumpy overall. And then you can even change like the meter type. So there's an analog meter type, which looks like this. And some people may like that. I think it looks pretty cool, but it is kind of big overall. And I kind of prefer digital meters. So I have the digital mode on like that. Then over here, it shows you if you're going into like an eco or power mode. And then if you're also charging the battery, I do watch this meter a lot to see if I'm using the power or not. And I try to accelerate very slowly so that I stay in this eco mode and use less gas. So pardon all the dust, I am on a road trip after all. But down here, there's an eco driving mode, a sport mode, which is actually very zippy. And then there's also a normal mode. So I usually keep this on eco mode. And then there's even a trail mode here, which you can use when you're on a trail, or I guess a more bumpy kind of road. And I used this kind of for the first time the other day when I was driving over a bunch of rocks and stuff. And I think it made a little bit of a difference, though it wasn't super apparent that this was actually doing something in terms of the smoothness of the ride. So I'm not sure if I was doing that correctly, but it's there. And then there's also a forced EV mode, which also works pretty well if you're going under 25 miles per hour and you have some of the battery charged. And then this hold button is for when you are stopped, your car will automatically kind of go into a temporary park mode. This right here feels pretty nice. Overall, it's pretty easy to shift. Down here is a wireless charging pad, and you can turn it on and off with this button. So you can see like it's enabled when you see that green. You can also turn that off if you're not using it. Down here is where you can charge your phone and also plug it in so that you can use CarPlay on the screen. So let's actually turn CarPlay on here. I'll plug my phone in, and you can see what it looks like when CarPlay is actually plugged in. And it usually just automatically connects to it. And this is what the home screen looks like. I think it's a little bit slow right now because I'm also filming at the same time, so it's a little choppy, but usually it's a little bit quicker. It's a little bit snappier. I really like these gigantic buttons on the air conditioner and the heater over here. And it does have dual zone climate control. So you can do, you know, something different over here, or you can press sync and then it'll sync all your settings, you know, as you're over here, it'll change together. The layout is very intuitive for changing all these settings. And down here, this is super important in Texas, especially where it's so hot. We have heated and cooled seats, so you can change how much coolness you want there. You can see there's three levels there. And then you just press that button if you want to turn it off. And then if you want to heat your side, these little LEDs turn orange and you can change the level of heat. The interior everywhere has this kind of faux leather, I think it's called Softex, texture to it, which makes the car feel kind of more premium, I think. And the stitching over here, I think, looks really nice in general. There's not a whole lot of storage over here except for this tiny little really handy compartment, which I use to put my keys and a credit card and a mask and stuff. So let's check out this button. So when I press this on the screen, you'll see this really cool animation of a 360 degree camera view. So I really like seeing the top view, especially of this car, because that really helps when I'm parking. Especially, you can see if you're close to the car next to you, you can see if you're lined up correctly or if there's any obstacles in the front or behind you. And the rear backup camera is also very handy. There's a few different views here. This is the view that I usually do, where there's a top view over here and then a super wide angle view behind you, but you can also change that to different views, like an ultra wide view, which is kind of handy. And then this one's just like your normal reverse camera. The rear view mirror is really cool. So it has this normal kind of view, which is just a mirror. But then when you flip it, it does a digital camera version of what's behind you. I really prefer this digital camera view though. It feels very strange when you first start using it. It's like, whoa, everything feels a little closer. It's a pretty high resolution screen too. You can see there's actually quite a bit of detail behind me. Up here are lights and stuff, nothing fancy. This is what controls the panoramic sunroof. Let's open up the sunroof right now so you can see. So you just press that and wow, that's dirty. But you get the full panoramic sunroof in this limited edition. So here's something that the RAV4 has that the Prius didn't. When this sun visor goes down and extends over here out like this, and the Prius didn't have this extender, so it would just kind of stop, and then the sun always seemed like it found a way to come in right in the perfect spot here and blind me. But I love that this has the extender, and it has it on both sides, the driver's side and the passenger side over there. The armrest here in the middle has a little bit of padding on it, so it feels a little soft. It's pretty comfortable. It does feel a little bit low though when I'm driving, but when you open it up, it's somewhat deep. But yeah, if you have a small bag or something, it fits in there very nicely. Close it up. So let's open the trunk so you can see just how much room is in the back of this thing. And you can see when you have those back seats down, they don't lay completely flat, but it's flat enough. So if you were thinking about actually sleeping in this car, which I haven't yet, but I kind of want to, you could totally do that. You know, I'm about 5'10", and I could easily fit my entire body in the back of this car. And you can also see that since this is the limited version of the RAV4, it has these extra JBL speakers. And the sound system, I think, is really, really good. It's not, you know, the most perfect thing in the world, but for a car sound system, I think it sounds phenomenal. And here you can actually see the sunroof, the panoramic sunroof. That's what it looks like closed. And I have it closed right now because the sun is coming in a lot and it does let a lot of heat in. So I usually leave that closed until about sunset. And then once that sun is set, I mean, you open this thing up and you can just see everything. It looks really, really cool. So let's actually put up one of the back seats so you can see what that looks like. So you just simply pull it back. It kind of locks into place. Because this is the limited trim, it does have this Softex faux leather. And here's one of the cons that I can actually think of. So you can see this tiny white dot. This may be a speck of dust or dirt or food or something. But since these seats have ventilation, because these actually are heated seats in the back, and then the front seats are heated and cooled. But yeah, little tiny stuff will actually get stuck in these little holes, and usually you can just vacuum that and they'll come right out, but it is a little annoying and it does make it seem a little dirty. But overall, I find these seats to be very comfortable. I give them about an 8 out of 10 in terms of comfort, and it's really easy to put them down, also to lay them flat. You just pull that lever and then you let it down. I ended up getting the extra rubber mats. I think they were about $100. So I have the back seat covered here, and then under here is also a rubber mat. I really like those kinds of things on top of my seats because I do have two pit bulls and they can be pretty rowdy. So I like that the seats on the back are protected, and these just kind of Velcro in. Nothing fancy, but this is the actual seat back. One of the complaints that I've seen about the RAV4 2020 and 2021 edition is when the back door is open, it doesn't really open at that much of an angle. So for me, it's not a huge deal, but sometimes I do wish this opened like at more of an angle. And sometimes, you know, my dog's jumping in from here, sometimes they'll kind of knock into the side here because they're trying to get up, and I do wish these doors opened just a little more, but that's not the end of the world. And checking out this door too, I mean, I really, really like the style of this with this kind of faux leather on the side here. And you can see this like angular kind of vibe, and it's kind of the whole aesthetic of this car. It's supposed to be, I guess, like a very sharp and angled kind of car. You can see this fin towards the back here, and it kind of continues over here. Let's open up the front passenger side now. It seems like it opens a little bit more actually than the back seat. So here's what it looks like when you are a passenger in this car. And again, you have that same kind of Softex fake leather feel. Here's some more crumbs and stuff that drive me a little nuts. There's one right there. The front seats have heating and cooling, and the cooling works pretty well. I haven't tried the heating yet because I haven't needed it. So on the passenger side, there is a little bit of storage right here, which is really handy. You can easily fit a few phones or your keys or something on there. The glove compartment does feel kind of tiny. And when it comes to storage, I do wish there was a little more storage here, especially in the front, because there's only two cup holders here, which work okay, but I wish there was like another one here or something. I don't know exactly where they would put it in this model, but the storage in the front does leave some to be desired. So one of the main issues that I found with the RAV4, and it's not a deal breaker, but it is something I noticed, is I just had to fill up my tank. I was down to about 20 miles till empty. The tank is apparently 14.5 gallons, and every time I fill my tank up, I only get about 10 gallons before it stops and I can't fill the tank anymore. So this should say like, you know, 14.5, 14 or something, but I can't seem to fill it more than 10 gallons. And according to Toyota, when you fill up your tank, you're supposed to get about 580 to 590 miles until you're empty on a full tank. And as you can see here, I just filled up and the distance to empty only says 492. So there's a definite issue with the gas tank, and it's not something where my car's gonna, you know, stop working or anything, but it doesn't fill up to the rated amount. You know, I should be seeing 580. That would really help me a lot on this road trip, of course. That would mean less stops to gas stations. And this is a known issue. There are a lot of people that have reported this, and apparently Toyota even has acknowledged this issue, and you can bring your RAV4 into a dealership and they can exchange your gas tank for a different design. So overall, I am loving the RAV4 Hybrid Limited so far. It drives pretty smoothly. Overall, it gets really, really excellent miles per gallon, way more than I thought it would. I think it looks really sweet. You know, it just has a really nice aesthetic. It feels sporty, it feels solid. I feel high off the ground, but not too high where it feels like I'm just gonna sway and like, you know, fall off the freaking side of the road. And it just feels like a very safe and sturdy car, where sometimes the Prius, you know, it felt like a safe car, but the Prius did feel a lot lower to the ground, and it was really hard sometimes to see over cars or obstacles sometimes when you're trying to make a turn, and it felt kind of unsafe, like I was actually guessing a lot. But if you can find one, I would highly recommend you check out a RAV4 Hybrid. And I do think the hybrid is worth spending that extra money if you have it, because you will get really, really good gas mileage. I can't believe I'm getting 44 miles to the gallon. You know, it's 10 miles less than what I was getting with my Prius, but for a car this big, that's really, really impressive. And yeah, I think in general, this car is just super fun to drive in, and the road trip experience has been really, really amazing. So if you have any questions about the RAV4, let me know in the comments below. I'm gonna continue on my road trip here. I hope you really enjoyed this video. If you did, please smash the like button. The algorithm loves that. Add me on social media, Twitter, Instagram, at B3NAQUA. Thanks for watching this video. I really appreciate your support, and I will see you in the next one.